This is Shinkin.
Thank Professor Sabyasachi for his insights into the culture of Adivasis. I have lived many, many years ago, you know, in Adivasi areas, but perhaps I did not experience, I may not have lived that long and experienced all the brilliant insights that he was, or sensitive insights that he was able to. And I must say that I learned quite a bit hearing him narrate his experiences. Vijay has given me a very difficult, mundane kind of topic to talk about after this kind of presentation that you've heard. But I'm going to try and turn that topic around to suit my way of looking at this. So the topic he has given is challenges for herbal medicine, whatever that means. And you know, policy options and so on and so forth. I'm going to interpret this to say, and in some sense to continue with the line of some line of thinking that was presented by the previous speaker, and really going to start with discussing about what are the policy options for our health system, you know. And here my own observation is that the nature of our health system as it functions today is something that we have imported, as we have done many other systems, including, you know, agriculture or education, or for that matter science and technology, is something that we have, I'm talking now of course of health, we have imported our health system from outside, from essentially the West. And the nature of our health system is currently, as we know, and Rituprija is sort of, you know, formally engaged with this health system, even if she's a critique of it. The nature of our health system is a three-tiered institutionally managed system, where you have primary health care, secondary health care, tertiary health care, and all of this managed and rendered by the state, by the government largely. Of course, there are also private actors, particularly in tertiary care, partially in secondary care. There are also private players, because government is unable to manage that layer of the system. But you have a three-layered institutional system, largely run by government across the country, but also in a substantial way with private players in it. So it's an institutionalized system. I think that we will never achieve self-reliance or adequate health security for our people through this kind of a system. And in the decades that we have executed this system, from independence till date, we know that right here in the start of the so-called 12th five-year plan, it was observed that the majority of our people, I mean, the goal of this health system, this three-tiered health system, was to provide universal health coverage. And it was observed at the beginning of this 12th plan that we are nowhere near achieving universal health coverage. The majority of our population, almost 70% of the population, is actually managing its health care by paying from their own pocket, out of pocket or whatever. So the health system is not delivering, despite huge amounts of investments that have been made from taxpayers' money in plan after plan after plan, and, you know, expanding this institutional network. And of course, the latest thing that has been happening since 2005 is the National Rural Health Mission, Now, my own thinking is that we need to extend now the layers of this, the tires of this three-tiered institutional system, and add two more, recognize two more tires, not really add, recognize two more tires that are already there in the society. And those tires are, one, knowledge that is there in households across all ethnic communities of this country. I mean, and those ethnic communities, according to the Anthropological Survey of India, we have around 4,630 odd ethnic communities, of which 500 are the tribal communities. How many of them are still Adivasis and how many of them have become tribal, that is another matter. But we have 4,600 odd ethnic communities, and every single ethnic community has a household healthcare tradition, and each one of us sitting in this room are also carriers of that household health tradition. It is reflected in our ethnic diets. Every single diet is designed in a particular way. Everything that we have, whether it's in the north, south, east, west, northeast, anywhere, the diets that we have are designed with a health purpose in mind. And we have home remedies at home. Some of them, or a large number of them, are eroding, but if you even today survey across the homes of India, I can assure you that you will find at least 100 different solutions to treatment, management of common ailments, or for prevention, or for wellness. Even today, you will find them. I mean, one classical example that I can give you, or two classical examples that I can give you at home level. One is about drinking water. In tradition, we had the cheapest, most effective method for microbial purification of drinking water. There's no need for aqua guards and RO systems and whatever, you know, all these different point of use solutions that are being today offered to us in the market. The traditional solution for microbial purification, I'm not talking of more recent problems that have come into water, which is due to chemical pollution, partly to pesticides and fertilizers, partly due to other reasons where, you know, you have areas in which you have lead contamination or arsenic contamination or fluoride and so on and so forth. Microbial purification, the cheapest solution was storing water in copper vessels. Even in Adivasi areas where I have lived, there was a time, and this is not very long ago, I've lived there, you know, in the 70s. And I used to see that drinking water, even in an Adivasi home, was stored in a copper pot. Subsequently, for various reasons, now they have sold off their economic reasons, really. They have sold off their copper vessels and substituted them perhaps for aluminium or for plastic, not realizing what change this is bringing about. Now, it is known, so far as the external effect of copper on water is, that, you know, within 12 hours of storing water in copper, every form of pathogenic microbes get completely eradicated. You know, whether it is E. coli, whether it is the thing that causes typhoid, Salmonella, Shigella, Vibrio cholera, Giardia, even rotavirus, all the pathogenic organisms get completely eradicated. So this was a household practice, you know, across millions of homes, north, south, east, west of India. Or, you know, these days there is great deal of talk about the use of turmeric, and there is a lot of scientific papers on the benefits of turmeric or these papers are more focused on active ingredients from turmeric, curcumin, and there are several other compounds. And gradually they are finding that it is not really one active ingredient like curcumin, but a number of components of turmeric that are effective. And I think finally they'll come to the conclusion that turmeric in its natural form is probably the most effective way to use it. They're coming around to that. But I'm saying if you look at the use of turmeric in every house, irrespective of the economic or social status, I mean there's not a single food that we eat where we don't add some pinch of turmeric in it. We're not doing it for taste. We're not doing it for color. It is a health practice. And it's a health practice that was introduced centuries ago, discovered perhaps by the kind of epistemologies that Professor Sabyasachi spoke about, you know, the properties, because they certainly didn't discover it for its limited scientific properties, which have now slowly coming to light, like anti-inflammatory or anti-cancer or a whole lot of limited activities are coming into play. Just as an aside, since we were talking about epistemologies and science and ways of knowing, of course science is a way of knowing. It is a particular way of knowing. It gives you some knowledge about properties. It may not give you the kind of knowledge that an Adivasi would have gathered through other ways of knowing, but it certainly gives you some knowledge of properties. But you know, the method of science, particularly relating to plants and the way they find out about plants, if you were to sum it up, you would find the limitation of that method. I mean, what if I want to know the property of tulsi, or if I want to know the property of turmeric, which I spoke about earlier. So how does science go about finding the property of tulsi or finding out the property of turmeric? So there are chemists who break up that material into its compounds, into its chemicals, and they identify so-called active ingredients. Actually, we don't know which is active and which is not, or how many make up the activity, but you know, we pick up compounds that do have some activity and we call them active ingredients. They may very well be, because a material has so many compounds in it, they very well may be synergistic effects and all kinds of things. But the way we study plants in science is that we break it up into its components, chemical components, and then we take therefore bits of a plant and then we test them out on biological parts of the biological system, parts. So you don't have a way of testing a whole plant on the whole system. The method of science in pharmacology, as we call it, is testing part of plant on part of biology. So you study it on a cell line, or you study it on an organism. Is it antiviral? Is it antibacterial? You know, does it work on this cell or that cell? But what does it do to the entire body? There's no method to find that out. So you really have very partial understanding about a plant, even when you use the most advanced of scientific methods. So that's just on the side that I'm saying this. So coming back to, I'm saying that we need to look at a health system that restores the Indian reality of healthcare. Our current health system is an imported health system where you have derived this three-tiered state-managed institutionalized system of healthcare from outside. And while that might have certain advantages or might have certain benefits, it certainly is not doing a good job or a sufficient job, as we can see from the data of the way our health system functions, that even after 6-7 decades of huge investments, majority of the population is still paying from out of its pocket. So it is not really delivering universal health care. So I'm saying at this stage we need to restore the Indian-ness of our healthcare system, which is bring back those two tires that have been neglected, the household level of knowledge and the community level of knowledge. And the community level of knowledge would include the knowledge of different communities, different ethnic communities. You heard the story of the tribal community and the richness of their tradition and their knowledge, which is one of the ethnic traditions, and there would be others across. We have got 4,600 ethnic communities. 500 of them fall in the category of tribals, and there are a whole lot of other communities, and there is knowledge in all. So we have to restore the knowledge of the community, we have to restore the knowledge of the household, we have to recognize that these should form part of the health system. And in that context, I will take the topic that Vijay has assigned to me, because it so happens that in the Indian tradition, across our ethnic community, plants is a large source of health care. There are around 6,500 species of plants across the various ecosystems that are known for their medicinal use for either humans or for livestock that humans manage, or even for agriculture itself. They are also, plants are used to heal plants, you know, all the three things. And we have this local traditions, the ethnic traditions, which I call the Prakrit Parampara. Prakrit meaning, you know, we have really two, I mean, I use two terms. You have the Prakrit Parampara, which is the knowledge that communities have, which they have derived directly from their relationship with nature. Just like Prakriti is nature, all Prakrit traditions are the traditions that are derived from Prakriti, from nature. That's why they are called Prakrit Paramparas in a particular language, way of using words. And then there are the Sanskrit traditions. The Sanskrit tradition, there is no such word in Indian tradition called Sanskrit, S-A-N. The only word is Sanskrit. And the word Sanskrit does not necessarily stand for language. It stands for samskar, on kriti, prakriti, samskriti. Samskriti means to modify prakriti becomes samskriti. Some modification on prakriti becomes samskriti. So the Sanskrit traditions are the traditions which are the modifications from Prakrit traditions. There can be no samskriti without prakriti, because all samskriti is derived from prakriti. From nature only, when you modify prakriti, you get samskriti. Without prakriti, there is no samskriti. So all knowledge systems are part of samskriti. They are Sanskrit traditions. So in Indian tradition, in the healthcare scenario, you have a huge Prakrit tradition of healthcare. The tribal and Adivasi traditions is one aspect of this Prakrit tradition, and you've heard some accounts and narration of the experiences of this particular Prakrit tradition of the Adivasis. It's quite a fascinating account. I'm sure you've all enjoyed hearing it. So you can see the richness and depth of the entire Prakrit tradition. So you're not working in empty space. You know, the household traditions or the community traditions have a huge wealth of information. And just in terms of resources, I'm telling you, there are 6,500 species of plants that have been documented to be used by this tradition. And you know, there are databases which can give you actually the list of these plants, both in terms of their Latin names and in terms of their vernacular names. And really to support what he was saying, I mean, in our university we have actually got a database on the medicinal plants known to the people of India, referenced from different sources. Every entry has a reference. And corresponding to 6,500 botanical names, there are over 200,000 vernacular names corresponding to those 6,500. So you can see the richness of the local knowledge, because those vernacular names show you that, you know, communities have recognized plants and have named them in their own ways. And I'm not going into their way of naming, which is very different kind of a taxonomy from the way of naming that you have in the Linnaeus system or in the botanical, modern botanical system of nomenclature. It's a completely different aspect of nomenclature. So in terms of policy interventions, if you want to strengthen herbal medicine in India, so to say, you have to strengthen the traditions of India, the health traditions of India, which is at the household level, which is at the community level, and recognize them and see that some part of the taxpayers' money, you know, goes into them. Today we are spending something of the order, and those of you who are not so familiar with this order, at least it's 200,000 crores in a particular 5-year plan. We spend something of the order of 200,000 crores on the health system. That's our, you know, 5-year budget for health system, of which zero goes into this, what I'm talking of, the two tires that I'm talking of. We don't invest a single penny into revitalizing either household knowledge or into revitalizing community knowledge. Nothing goes, for example, into tribal medicine. There is no such term, I mean, or Adivasi medicine. There's no such term. I mean, I happen to have worked for 5 years as an honorary advisor in the Planning Commission during the period 2007 to 2012, and I was able to put in a budget line into the Planning Commission's, you know, 5-year thing for local health traditions, which included all of this. And I was dismayed to find in 2014, when I recently visited the Ministry of Health, that they have decided to do away with that particular budget line and that whole scheme, because they say there are no takers for it. I mean, I don't know what they mean by there are no takers for it. There are 1 million community-based healers estimated in this country, which include tribal healers and healers from other ethnic communities, 1 million of them, but they are invisible to this government. And of course there are millions and millions of households, you know, who are carriers of health knowledge in terms of food, nutrition, home remedies, knowledge about prevention, like I'm saying. I mean, this knowledge of storing water in copper vessels is a home level knowledge. I mean, I can give you many, many examples of the value of this knowledge. You heard certain examples from him. I'll tell you what is the first thing I encountered when I was staying in a tribal area, in an Adivasi area. You know, I found a young man with a testicle swollen to double its size, and then a local healer, I was alarmed looking at that situation, and then a local healer walked up and he said there's no need to take this person anywhere. This was probably a condition what we call hydrocele, you know. And what did he do? He just went and he picked up a leaf of I don't know what you call it in North India, it's called Aak, Akra in Gujarati, we call it, in Sanskrit we call it Ark, Arka. That plant, just took a leaf of that, put a little oil and a little haldi, because it's a very, what we call ushna material. And he tied, he said, you just tie it on that testicle and wear the traditional langoti and change it every day. And the fourth day, the testicle was down to its normal size. And that is what actually got me impressed, you know, one of the things that got me really impressed about efficacy of this knowledge. So I started inquiring. I said, what is this property of this plant? And then I gathered, because you know, the Sanskrit tradition, the so-called Ayurveda tradition, is actually, all Sanskrit is derived from Prakrit. So there is a connection. I mean, you can get an idea of the nature of Prakrit traditions from the Sanskrit tradition, because they're just a modification, that is a generalization. They have looked into the principles, not the scientific principles in the way modern science looks at it, but in terms of our own ways of looking at it. And anyone who knows Sanskrit would know that the meaning, one of the meanings of the word Ark, Arka, that plant, or Ark, which is the local vernacular name, is the sun. So they have named this plant the sun. And the reason is that just like the sun can evaporate water because its heat, this plant has that same property. It can evaporate water, and you know, you can use this plant therefore for hydrosil anywhere where there is water accumulation. Even if you have this thing in the in the abdomen, the water in the abdomen, you can make a belt out of those leaves and you know, put it around, and you will probably have to have some other. Won't drink water, like he said in this case, and it will remove that water. You don't have to, normally you have to, you know, pull it out, and so on and so forth. So this would be my policy advice, a very serious policy advice, that if we want to improve health security of our people, we cannot have a system of healthcare in modern India which is entirely making the people dependent on institutions of primary, secondary or tertiary care. And these institutions are being used, they are needed and they have value, but they cannot deliver you the health security for our people. You have to restore the knowledge of the communities, you have to restore the knowledge of the households, you have to reduce the dependence of society on institutional health care. You have to bring back this, and that is require a strategy. That will require, I mean, it's a very, very serious task. How to do it, which is not going to be the subject of my discussion now. But therefore, this is one of the advice that I would give. I think it is necessary as part of this kind of a strategy to really develop for the whole country at the tehsil level, at the taluka level, herbal pharmacopoeias. A pharmacopoeia is something which will tell you about plants found, if it's a tehsil pharmacopoeia, the plants found in the tehsil and what is their health value. That knowledge of what is their health benefit need not be derived from pharmacology or from, you know, modern science. It can be derived from the local tradition. It can be derived from the codified traditions like Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, Swarigpa, which is the knowledge in the Tibetan region. You know, we have very, very rich, can be derived from that. So, but we need to create these kinds of herbal pharmacopoeias in today's time. You know, we can use technology, you can use the ICT platform, you can create graphic databases or multimedia forms and put them into every single digital resource that is available in the taluka, into schools, colleges, panchayats, wherever digital media is available. I think we'll have to do lots of things like that. in order to restore these two tires. But that should be the strategy really for, that is the challenge for, you know, bringing back our knowledge into contemporary use. I don't know what was the intention Vijay had in wanting me to speak something about cultivation and so on and so forth, but I mean, this sort of a thing, what I'm saying is going to restore health security. I mean, the herbs in our country, the plants, and of course these plants are not only herbs. I mean, one third of the medicinal plants of India are trees. One third are shrubs, roughly. One third are grasses, climbers, and all that. You know, it's not really only the lower, it's not only the herbs that are medicinal. You have, neem, there are one third of our species are trees and parts of trees. And there's a lot of detail, you know, the flowers, fruits, stem, raisins, bark, roots, so many different parts. And each part, we have that knowledge and tradition of all this. So this, what I am saying, to restore household tradition, to restore community knowledge, is something that will add to health security. But if the intention is also to look at livelihood security, then perhaps we will also need to look at the whole business of modes of cultivation of these plants. And there again, an enlightened policy on or program on cultivation will have to take into account many more things than what modern agriculture teaches us. You just heard, the value of shifting cultivation in certain kinds of habitats, and the value of that for if you want to have access to material, at the same time you want to not destroy the ecosystem. If you want to conserve the ecosystem along with access to, then you will have to use that. So, today we only think organic agriculture is the only, of course, organic agriculture is very, very important. But what we mean by organic agriculture today is an agriculture that does not use chemical ingredients, fertilizers. But traditional agriculture is much more than merely being organic agriculture. If you want the properties of plants to be expressed, then in the codified Indian tradition, there is something called Vriksh Ayurveda. There are thoughts like Desh Vichar. Where does the best neem grow? It is neem grows in hot, dry, arid areas. The neem of Kerala is not medicinally, the neem of Rajasthan or the neem of any hot, dry, arid area. There are hot, dry, arid areas in every state. You don't have to only go to Rajasthan, but Rajasthan is a symbol of excellent neem, because generally it's hot, dry, arid place. So which habitat to grow it, what time to harvest it. Do you know the names of turmeric, the traditional names of turmeric? This is just an example. Nisha, Rajni, these are names of turmeric. And what does Nisha mean? What does Rajni mean? Night. So what it is saying is, if you want the properties of turmeric, harvest it in the night, not in the day. Today, all modern cultivation of turmeric takes place in a very different way. We have not bothered about habitat, we have not bothered about the time of harvesting it. Sometimes it is a nakshatra that is very important for harvesting, anything. How did they figure out that in that particular nakshatra you have optimum properties? We don't know. But that's a different epistemology. Perhaps someone had that kind of a dream or something, that was spoken about. And there are many other ways of knowing, by the way. We hardly understand the way learning takes place. We hardly understand the way in which knowledge is gained. I mean, we think that this modern method of learning, which is certain kind of limited sensory observation, all our modern scientific observations happen through certain instruments, you know, which extend the range of senses in a particular way. And then we analyze that sensory data just using certain schemes of logic and mathematics in what we could call in a rational way. And we arrive at some inferential knowledge and we say this is the, you know, scientific knowledge. There are so many other ways of knowing, there are so many other ways of observing. There are states of mind which are quite different from the rational state. And I don't think we should create in this society a divide between the Prakrit Parampara and the traditional Sanskrit Parampara. Yoga Shastra, for example, is derived from nature, you know. Entire Yoga Shastra is only, all the so-called asanas and kriyas and all that are only mimicking some natural form, but they have gone beyond that form into understanding the properties. And in Yoga Shastra we talk of so many different states of mind, you know, which are beyond the rational state. And in those states of mind, combined with the sensory observations, the nature of knowledge is quite different. The nature of evidence is quite different. And, you know, one can... So, I mean, there's a lot to be said about traditional epistemologies. You know, that's a subject in itself which is very, very deep and which is much beyond the epistemology of science. This epistemology of science is what it is. We are familiar with it because, you know, it is something that we've been schooled in our formal education system. But there is so much to really learn outside of our formal education system, and it's unfortunate that, you know, you are considered knowledgeable. An Adivasi is not considered knowledgeable at all, you know, because he hasn't been to school and college, but he has been through the school of life, he has been through parampara. Parampara is also a tremendous pedagogy, you know. I mean, so if someone looks at parampara, you know, how knowledge is transferred over generations. I mean, he was talking of snake bites, you know, we have something of the order of 60,000 Visha people who treat snake bites, and many of these are people who live in tribal areas but also in non-tribal areas. And that's a life-threatening condition, you know, snake bite. You can't be fooling around in managing a snake bite. Now there are 60,000, at least 60,000 people who know about snake bites north, south, east, west of India. And where did they learn? And where did they get the confidence to do what they're doing? Or bone setters. You know, we have a large number of bone setters. Now that's anatomy. And yet they haven't gone to any medical school. And they are setting primary fractures. Sometimes I have seen people setting compound fractures. And we can give you names and addresses of places that you can actually go to where you can see this traditional bone setting going on. And where public also goes. In fact, if you look at statistics, maybe 40% of broken bones in this country are still being managed by traditional bone setters and not by institutions. You look at midwifery, you know, I mean, the kind of knowledge that is there traditionally on midwifery is also enormous. I mean, we have 600,000 traditional midwives. It is so unfortunate that the National Rural Health Mission has as one of its unstated goals to actually destroy the tradition of midwifery, because they say that all deliveries must happen in institutions and there will be incentives given to people to come to institutions without anyway. This is the way in which the institutionalized three-tier system works. It also works at cross purposes with the rest of our traditions. I think I'll stop here. On livelihood security, yes, cultivation and processing and preparation, it has a big scope, but I mean an ideal livelihood program should take place using also the traditional knowledge relating to agriculture and not only be based on modern packages for agriculture. Then it will be a more creative kind of a program. And similarly in processing.
Corporate plundering se kaise bachayenge? Sustainable nurturance kaise hoga?
You see, livelihood enterprises require also support. Okay, now today we provide support for modern enterprise, and the banking system, the financial system, the management schools are all focused on, you know, people in this corporate sector. But how do you support decentralized manufacturing? How do you support decentralized production? How do you support community-owned enterprises and federating them? You know, these are all huge challenges. And today we have not got any institutional support, either financial or knowledge institutions or anybody to hold hands. The total size in this field, herbal industry, current turnover of India's herbal industry, the current turnover is estimated to be of the size of around 15,000 crore. That's the current turnover. That is includes the Dabur, the Himalayas and all that. Is around 15,000 crore. It's not a very huge size as compared to modern pharmaceuticals, which is maybe of the order of 75 to 80, 90,000 crore. This is only 15. But out of this 15,000, the size of community-based enterprises, the kind of livelihood that he's talking about, is less than 0.0001%. So you have practically nothing there in terms of livelihood security. The most knowledgeable people about, I mean, medicinal plants or herbs, or, you know, this knowledge has come from tradition. Modern science knows very little about herbal medicine, you know, very, very little. It has scattered knowledge of little chemistry, a little bit of incomplete biology, and it makes all sorts of allegations even on the basis of this incomplete knowledge about evidence and this, that and the other. And the nature of your own evidence is so scanty. But whatever knowledge or awareness there is anywhere in the world, for that matter, not only in India, about medicinal plants has come from tradition. Yet our investment into traditional knowledge of medicinal plants, either for health security or bringing it into the health system or for livelihood security, is negligible. So we'll have to put investments into this of an order, you know, not lip service as is going on. I mean, today World Bank or UNDP or this one or that one talk about livelihood security for the poor and this and that. And what do they put behind those intentions? Nothing, practically nothing. Which is why the size of the herbal sector, which is enterprises, is 0.001%. That's the facts on the ground. You know, out of a 15,000 crore turnover, the size of this is just that much. So which means that nothing is happening. Hardly anything is happening. So we will need to see how investments can be directed, how knowledge institutions can be directed. We don't have enough knowledge institutions working on any aspect of traditional knowledge, whether it is Adivasi knowledge or any other knowledge. We have actually, I mean, I want to say this as another aside, that we have this huge confusion about tradition and modernity created by, you know, Western trained sociologists, to my mind. modernity is in essence evolving tradition. There is the roots of modernity is tradition. There is no other way in which, I mean, the present can only come from the past. Our present is coming from someone else's past. The nature of our modernity is such that it is coming from someone else's past. Someone else has evolved their past in the West, and we think we have to import all our modernity. World is one place. You may import whatever you want, which you don't have, where you have a need. You can do that. But when you don't make use of your own to modernize yourself, the modernization of India is vastly incomplete process. Our modernization is entirely based on almost Western cultural intellectual tradition. This is absurd. Our modernization must come from our own roots. So this business that we are talking about, bringing these two tires into our healthcare system, is part of the modernization of healthcare in India. It is not one faddish kind of an agenda. If you want to modernize healthcare in India, you have to look at the contemporary relevance of our own traditional knowledge. Evolving tradition makes modernity. You have to adopt tradition to contemporary needs. You don't embrace tradition for nostalgia. You take from tradition what can serve your contemporary needs, and there is a great deal. But in all sectors, and this we are talking of health, there's a great deal in tradition that can contemporize healthcare in India. It will modernize healthcare in India. So it's a very, very important thing. It is not a marginal thing. It is part of the thing to restore, you know, bring strength, to bring contemporaneous, to bring vigor, to bring participation. For all these reasons, it's very, very important to look at this particular area.